If you haven't seen season 3 of Sherlock yet, don't worry. There are no life or death spoilers in here, but watch that first if you're worried. With that out of the way, are Sherlock Holmes and Charles Magnuson, the future of memory. Hi, my name is Emily, and this is Blink Pop Shifts. In the season finale of the BBC's Tumblr famous series Sherlock, everyone's favorite master consulting detective meets his match in Charles Augustus Magnuson, the Napoleon of blackmail. Magnuson has amassed a huge library of headline-breaking secrets, which he is using to control most of the powers in the Western world. Much of the episode is dedicated to tricking the audience into thinking that Magnuson is using a technological memory aid, perhaps reading the information off of a pair of not Google glasses. But those deliciously incriminating files are, however, and this is the only spoiler in this video, stored not in his wearable computer or even a Wi-Fi connected secure server, but in his head. All of the information he has collected is stored using a technique called a memory palace, where memories are associated with an imagined physical location, making large quantities of detailed information easily accessible and retainable. Sherlock also uses this technique to solve his cases, but what if you could do the same? Will seamless brain-computer interfaces change everything about how we think, remember, and use information? For a bit of historical perspective, let's go back to the invention of the first information technology, writing. Plato decried the invention of writing, saying, "This invention will produce forgetfulness in the minds of those that learn to use it because they will not practice their memory." Grump. From the position of oral tradition, maybe he's right, but think of all we accomplished once we unburdened our minds of the responsibility of remembering the entire cultural lineage of our species. Once we stopped having to remember all of our origin stories and gods and myths and medicines, we started using our minds more efficiently. Plato may have disagreed, but here's how James Gleick put it in his book, The Information. "We may wish to understand the rise of literacy, both historically and logically, but both history and logic are themselves products of literate thought. Writing permits whole new architectures of information, among them history, law, business, mathematics, and logic. And that's the point. While being decried as the death of memory, writing became a tool which led to new means of organizing information. New means so powerful that we cannot now understand the world without them. Now back to Sherlock and the brain-computer interface. Sherlock's prowess is not just his excellent observational skills, but also his ability to hold in mind a huge quantity of context. As Magnuson proves, individual facts are all well and good, but only in the context of big data do those facts become powerful. Sherlock's near instant access to and seamless use of statistical models of human behavior, maps, data on decomposition, weather, the chemical composition of various kinds of tobacco, and on let him cull amazing insights from very few clues. And I think with a powerful enough brain-computer interface, you and I will be able to do the same, creating an indispensable new architecture of information. Technology is still pretty far off from giving even us pea brains those same powers, but there are researchers working on interfaces that can read your brainwaves and translate them into real-world actions. We don't know yet what things the tool of a truly transactive computational memory will allow us to create, but people then may look back on us now and our pre-wired brains in much the same way as we see pre-literate people now.
Dear God, what is it like in your funny little brains? It must be so boring.
But what do you think? Will brain-computer interfaces advance to give us Sherlockian powers of observation and deduction? And what new architectures of information do you think will be unleashed by such an invention? I'm going to be making an Ask Emily video very soon, so if you have any questions about me or any of the topics that I've covered, please ask below on Tumblr or at Emily Eifler. And as always, the game is on and get curious.
Is the show really over?
But, I mean, without all that eye-flicking stuff, seriously, did you have to make him into eye-flicking and licking people and peeing on things? Gross. No, clues. Clues. Grump. Grump, grump, grump. Changing the script. Changing the script. Alright. From the position of...